Okay. This always happens. I'm doing my daughter's school quiz next week, and it happens every year. Hello, is this on? It
makes me feel so much better.
Oh, that's better.
Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to Birmingham City University's Parkside building. My name is Professor Ian Blair, and I'm Pro Vice Chancellor and Executive Dean of the Faculty of Health, Education and Life Sciences here at the University. I'd like to wish you all a very warm welcome to the first City Talk of this year. For those of you who are new to the City Talk series, the rationale behind the series is to demonstrate that we are a university without walls, and to invite staff, students, and the general public to engage and to talk to us, ask questions, and access all that the university has to offer. We are delighted to launch this year's series by welcoming back BAFTA award-winning comedian Joe Brand. With a successful career spanning over 25 years, Joe has appeared on television programmes such as Getting On, QI, Have I Got News For You, and the Great British Bake Off Extra Slice. However, comedy wasn't Joe's original calling, and her career path began as she trained originally as a mental health nurse, and actually that's what brought her to our attention within the Faculty of Health, Education and Life Sciences. In recognition of Joe's continued commitment to raising awareness around mental health issues, the university awarded Joe an honorary doctorate in 2016. We are honored to welcome Joe back to the university to share her story with us tonight. Interviewing Joe this evening is a former Birmingham City University student and now reporter on ITV Anglia, Serena Sandu. In a moment, I'll pass you over to Serena, who will lead this evening in conversation, and who will invite questions from the audience towards the end of the talk. We encourage the audience to engage and share their thoughts during the evening via Twitter using the hashtag BCUCityTalks. We're not expecting a fire drill this evening. We did have three of them this afternoon, but none this evening. So if the alarm does sound, please make your way to the nearest available exit and follow the illuminated fire exit signs and instructions from staff. So, without further ado, I shall hand you over to Serena to begin this evening's event.
Well, hello. I hope it's all right for me to keep sitting down here, but this is too comfy for me to get up. So, my name's Serena. As was said, I am a former Birmingham City Uni student. I graduated in 2007 over from the Perry Barr campus. I did a postgraduate diploma in broadcast journalism, and it's my first time here at this campus, and to see the facilities that you have here, absolutely amazing. The green screen studio that you've got is just fantastic. So everything that they've got for students here is brilliant. And the sort of the skills that I learnt from my diploma here really put me in good stead for my career in journalism. I managed to get onto the ITV bursary scheme, and from there I worked at ITV Central, obviously here in Birmingham, went up to Manchester, and then finally that took me to Norwich, where I am now a reporter for ITV Anglia, and I work in Essex and sort of go all around the region. But it's absolutely brilliant to be back here in Birmingham. My family are still here in the Midlands, so to come back and be surrounded by people that I love and the accents that I love to hear and I've missed for so long as well, and people can actually understand me and I don't have to say that I'm drunk and anything to make up for it, so that's all fine. Right, how do you get on from my tales of journalism into comedy? So I thought I'd share with you my best joke. So why did the mushroom get invited to all of the parties? Yeah, okay. Well, thankfully, there's someone here that knows comedy a bit better than I do. So, Jo Brand, welcome. Thank you so much for coming here. It's brilliant to have you here.
Thank you very much. Can I say, first of all, it's quite disconcerting having that behind, because if something comes up and says, sort of, Jo Brand, what a boring twat. you're going to see it, and we're going to be facing the other way. Serena, brilliant interviewer, Jo Brand. Oh, my God, look at the state of her. Has she just been in the car for 4 hours, dying for a piss for three of them? I have. And so can you kind of just vaguely let me... Well, if you just laugh, I'm sure I'll look round and go, oh, yeah, that's true.
We haven't got a crap joke up there yet, have we, about mushrooms yet? So I think we're OK. I think we're OK.
We'll look out for it.
Okay, so Jo, as was said, you've had a long career spanning, you know, 25 years.
Not at all.
But it's been a varied career as well. So you started off as a psychiatric nurse and then obviously moved into comedy. So what was it that made you want to pursue that career in nursing at the start?
Well, I was kind of pushed into it by my mum, really, because I was kind of going nowhere. I got thrown out of home when I was 16 for being not a very good daughter and quite badly behaved and going out with a local drug dealer, you know, all the things your parents love. And my parents were splitting up at the time, which made it very difficult. Plus, my father had undiagnosed depression, and he was a very difficult person to live with. So naturally, we kind of locked horns. And in the end, they gave me a choice. Stay at home and get rid of the boyfriend or leave. So what a great choice. I left immediately. But then I was kind of worked in a series of, I wouldn't exactly say dead end jobs, because I loved all of them really. I was a waitress. I had a job pulling the heads off chrysanthemums in a flower nursery. That's fun. I just did like lots of, I was a cleaner in a TB hospital for a while. So, you know, I kind of saw the world in a way. And then my mum kind of bullied me in a way into doing a degree course which had a nurse training attached to it, because she kind of knew that I wanted to do comedy. So she said, you need to have something you can fall back on. So that's originally why I started doing psychiatric nursing. And I presumably a therapist would tell me that the fact that my dad had depression was something to do with it, but I haven't really looked into that myself.
Obviously, sort of working in mental health, you'd have thrown up some challenging sort of moments in there as well. And I remember reading there was someone that tried to attack you with a machete, so
yes. Well, actually, he didn't actually try and attack me, but I can't really go into too much detail because he's still in a secure hospital. But that was like 1986, and he turned up at the hospital having read his notes, and he didn't really like what he heard. I wasn't looking after him or anything. I was just someone that he knew quite well in the emergency clinic where I worked, and he was very, very angry. He had no impulse control, so he turned up with a big bag of weapons and walked around the hospital kind of waving a machete, and I was sent down there to try and calm him down. Lucky me! And actually, thankfully, I did get on very well with him, and he did say to me, look, it's pointless, I'm too angry, just go and don't let anyone come down here. And in the end, I think there were like 30 riot police had to come and sort the situation out. It was awful. Yeah, really awful.
I mean, do you think mental health in general is a subject that is talked about enough, or do you think it is still taboo?
Well, I think it's much less taboo than it was. I mean, in my father's day, for example, my dad had depression since he was a teenager, but he was just too ashamed to do anything about it. And he didn't actually see anyone and get a psychiatric assessment of any kind until he's in his mid-50s. So I think things are much better than they were. And I also think, given the kind of explosion in communication, you know, I think in my day, people that were receiving treatment didn't really have much of a say in how their treatment was organised and how they were treated by nurses and the like. And a lot of hospitals were closed institutions, which were almost like a cross between a village and a prison camp. So not much communication came out of them, and sort of institutionalised systems developed, because the staff were as institutionalised as the service users, you know, and it kind of made life very difficult for everyone. And so things have changed enormously since they closed down the great big hospitals. But I'm ambivalent about that, because I feel that people were pushed out into the community to save money, using the excuse that it was much better for people with mental health issues to be integrated into the community. But I used to go out and visit people, and no way were they integrated into the community. People were frightened of them, or they didn't want to get to know them. And that these were individuals living on their own in hard-to-let blocks of flats right at on the top floor, and just suffering probably more than they did if they'd been in a big hospital, where at least they would have had some company and people to socialise with. So there were a lot of problems with it, really, in the 80s, I think.
And obviously, the NHS nowadays, obviously, we're talking a lot of cost-cutting as well. There are nurses are at a shortage. What's your view on that, the whole, where do you see nurses, how they fit into the whole NHS as a profession?
Well, I mean, the attitude towards nurses has changed, again, massively since I was a nurse, because I trained in the 70s and 80s, and I was one of the first degree nurses. And nursing was two-tier in those days. You had, SRNs, who were qualified general nurses, but you also had nurses called SENs, who were state-enrolled nurses, who were sort of a tier below, who would do like the slightly more menial jobs and weren't kind of considered to be as academic as the more qualified nurses. And that's all gone now, you know, and I think every nurse, correct me if I'm wrong, gets a degree these days. And again, I have kind of mixed feelings about that, really, because to me, when I was a nurse in the emergency clinic, which is like a 24-hour psychiatric casualty department, to me, the long-standing SENs who'd been there years and knew everyone, knew the area, were kind of solid as a rock. In a way, I would much rather have had them there in a crisis than I would a newly qualified staff nurse who didn't really know what they were doing and didn't have the experience. So, I mean, I'll just give you a very, very quick example. We had a nurse actually forced on us, who really, God bless her, was totally tactless and didn't really know, hadn't picked up anything about how to interact with people. And she was a staff nurse, so she's in charge one day. And this guy that we all knew very well, who was someone who was like seriously psychotic on occasion, and would come to hospital, be treated, go home, not take his tablets anymore, and relapse. Anyway, he came in after he'd relapsed, very angry, with a knife, and said to her, "I want to be seen now." And she looked at him and went, "Sit down and be quiet, right?" And he broke her nose. Now, I'm not saying that she deserved that, but if she had had any clue whatsoever how to deal with someone that disturbed, that emotionally labile in a crisis, then she wouldn't have treated him like that, you know. And so those are the sorts of things that are kind of very important if you're working in that kind of area.
So what made you want to leave that profession behind?
Well, nothing made me want to leave, really, because I loved it. But I mean, I do actually believe if you work in... I mean, I worked in South East London, which is a kind of very up sort of area, shall we say. There's a lot of crime, there's a lot of drugs, it's a fantastic place. But the sort of people that we saw all the time weren't that easy to manage, shall we say, sometimes. And, you know, a lot of homeless people graduated towards the area. A lot of alcohol problems, a lot of drug problems because of the poverty of the area. You know, it was a challenging area to work in. And I feel that as a nurse, you can only kind of give so much of yourself without it negatively affecting you. And I saw nurses either become burnt out and withdraw. So we had one staff nurse, for example, who'd been there kind of too long, 25 years, and all he ever did was follow a piece of paper around the department. You know, you never actually saw him talk to anyone. So we had that, and then you would have people who sort of had their sensitive edges rubbed off them, and they, what I consider to be, had become a bit cruel, really, because they didn't really care anymore because they were so knackered by it all. So I'd done it for 10 years, and I felt that that was a good time to move on, really, or I might become a paper chaser or a sadist. Better to be a sadist on stage.
So we'll come to your on stage bits in a little while, but going sort of, how did you draw on your experience in the NHS when it came to comedy? So getting on the sitcom that was, you know, did you draw on your experiences? Were they sort of your own personal stories that you brought to life on screen there?
There were some of my personal stories in. I worked for 6 months as a student with the elderly, and I have a real strong feeling about sort of older people, how you just become completely invisible, particularly if you're a woman, to some extent, as you get older. And it's really fucking irritating, to be honest. And it's kind of happening to me because, I mean, I'm 60 this year, so that is very old, isn't it? And I kind of, oldish. All right, I'm not 85, but I'm not going to last that long. Anyway, but, you know, I kind of see it happening to older women, and I kind of feel it's the duty of older women to kind of put that right, you know. So I try not to be a kind of stereotype. Like, I'm quite grumpy. I know older women are quite grumpy, but I use that grumpiness against people that deserve it. Or, and the other thing I like doing is I like frightening teenage boys. Because I think teenage boys as a group are terrifying if you're a woman, right, you know. And like, for example, a few years ago in the winter, I was walking down on my own to get a paper, and there was a lot of snow on the ground, and there was a group of like six teenage boys, and they were all throwing snowballs at the cars, right, which, you know, is a slightly dangerous. And a car came up the road with a very, very old person in it, and I knew it was a really old person because it looked like no one was driving. They're so low like that that you can't actually see anyone in the car. And they chucked a snowball at this car, and she kind of, it was a woman, and she sort of swerved a bit. And I thought, I've got to go and say something. But I think if you're, like, don't go and do what they expect, you know, don't, like, be a bit surprising. So don't kind of go and say, how dare you, young men, this is outrageous, you know. So basically, I just started to run at them, which is quite, it's quite scary. When I start running, I don't stop unless I meet a wall normally. And I thought, I've got to shout something that they won't expect. So I just shouted, who wants a blowjob? They were terrified. It kind of had the right effect. Sorry, that's awful, isn't it? But that's the sort of thing I think you should do, because people just expect us as we get older to be kind of docile and to go, oh, I'm 83, my back hurts, you know. And I actually think that actually as a force, people that are older can potentially be very powerful, because economically there's a lot of us, and apparently we've all got loads more money than young people.
So is there anything maybe that you sort of would want to do now that you've not done so far?
Skydiving?
Skydiving?
Skydiving. Oh my God. No, I don't really like heights or flying that much. So that would be the worst combination of everything I could possibly imagine. Not skydiving. What would I like to? I'd like to be Prime Minister for a year. But, you know, that's not going to happen, so that's all right.
So say you were Prime Minister for a year, say it happened, what would be your first sort of policy change?
I'd put taxes up for very wealthy people, for a start. 95%. I'd put tax avoiders in prison, like Philip Green, and... I would redirect money where I think it should go, and I think society is, it's not a question of easy solutions, it's very complex, isn't it? And I think if you look at, like there's a kind of irony in the fact that we're telling people to stop eating so much and stop smoking so much and don't take drugs and don't do exercise, because actually everyone's living longer and we haven't got the facilities to look after them. So my advice to people is get back on the fags, enjoy, die young. Don't linger and be... What that awful thing is they call people a bed blocker, for God's sake. That's so... You know, and it's because the system's just organised wrong. I reckon I could reorganise it, but then again, I am slightly overconfident sometimes. I probably couldn't.
So your sitcom Damned has sort of raised awareness of social care. So
well,
again,
no, social work, is it Getting On was about a hospital unit with mainly elderly people on it, and Damned is about social services, the children's department.
So why is it that you want to sort of raise awareness of that? Why did you decide to do something like that?
Well, it's not because I want to raise awareness, it's because I want to make people laugh. So first and foremost, it's a sitcom, it's not an awareness raising exercise, but first of all, I know more about that than I know about anything else, so it's easier to write jokes about it. Secondly, as far as I'm aware, there hasn't ever been a sitcom about social workers. And I just feel it balances it up with all the blokes writing sitcoms about wanking. Sorry, am I being too rude? I'll masturbating, I mean.
So when did you first figure out you could make people laugh?
Well, I don't know really, because my father once did an interview for the Daily Mail, and said that I was very grumpy as a child and I wasn't funny. So that was very supportive of him. my dad was such a laugh in many ways. I remember he met a famous actress once when he was out for a walk. So he liked going rambling. And he met this famous actress and he never really liked what I did. He doesn't really like my stand-up at all, but he's kind of quite proud of the fact that I'm on telly. And he said to this actress, oh, my daughter's a comedian. And this actress went, oh, who is she? And he said my name. And then he turned to me after he was describing the visit and went, she doesn't think much of you. Yeah, just so I don't get too big-headed. That's what he's like. It's hilarious.
So would you say he's had a big influence on your life, really, your dad?
Yeah, he's made me hate men. Good luck to him. Sorry, I'm awful. I can't take anything seriously. You're looking at me. I can see the men looking at me like, my wife has dragged me along to this and I've made a big mistake here. I have a terrible trouble taking anything seriously. No, I don't hate men. I think men are fantastic as a concept. I think the problem with me with men always is I think actually most men are all right, but the bolshy sexist assholes that aren't are allowed to get away with it by other men. And if other men joined in with us and stopped them doing it, they wouldn't do it anymore. But at the moment, there's a transitional thing where you know, you're in a pub and some bloke's going, oh, look at the size of your tits or whatever it is. And all the other men are kind of looking the other way, although the vast majority of them, I hope, don't think that that's acceptable behaviour, but they still don't do anything about it, and that kind of irks me, really.
So what are your views on Donald Trump?
Well, I'm very jealous of Ivana, obviously, and Ivanka, and whatever other wives he's had his name for him and I. Marla. Oh, Marla Maples, that's right. God, that was a long time ago, wasn't it? So is it just the three? So far. I never know. What do I think of Donald Trump? Well, I think sort of Donald Trump is a kind of symbol of how desperate people in America are, really, that they actually think that someone like him can sort things out. You know, I feel very sorry for people who live in the middle of America, which is, you know, you've got Hollywood on one side and New York on the other side, and then a lot of people in the middle whose lives are really shit and they're really poor, and they've latched onto him because they think that he hates the metropolitan elite, which he does, and so therefore he must have their interests at heart. But the problems are going to be with him that he hasn't got a clue what he's doing, really. And he's the most thin-skinned person I've come across for a long time. And he's going to do something really appalling. I mean, I can't think... I hate to think what it might be. And he's a bully and he's a misogynist, you know. He's a racist. There's a long list of things he is, all of which I can't stand. And I just feel so sad that people felt so desperate, in a way like they did in this country, but to a much more minor degree, that they had to vote for someone like him.
Okay. Right, let's get it back onto the comedy scene now. So you said sort of in your personal life you used the snowball example of running towards the children and terrifying them.
They weren't children, you're making
them. Teenagers.
You make me sound like some horrible, abusive group, which actually I am. But only to my own children.
But when you first came on the comedy scene, people sort of said that you frightened men. You frightened men as well. So was that something you were looking to do, or was that just...
Yeah. Well, no, what I was looking to do was I was looking to even the balance, because for years women had watched men on TV, and we all know who they were, you know, who talked about women in what I consider to be the most appalling, disrespectful way. And so I kind of thought, I'm going to do that about men and see what happens. And because I think a lot of women had never kind of spoken back, you know, women are too, that, you know, were too scared for a long time to, if they had abuse shouted at them in the street, that they were too scared to sort of say something, you know, and I understand that. And I think the only thing that helped me was having worked in the emergency clinic, because I was a senior charge nurse for quite a few years. If somebody came in that wanted something, whether it be you know, tranquilizers to help them get off booze or admission or some money or whatever, and they couldn't get it because the doctor had said that they weren't being admitted or they weren't allowed to have any drugs, who got wheeled out to tell them the bad news? Me. So I was constantly kind of saying to people, I'm really sorry, you're not going to be admitted. And so I was the one who got like the massive mouthful of abuse, you know. So actually, when I started doing stand-up, someone going, fuck off, you fat cow, was relatively mild to me. So I found it much easier to deal with that sort of abuse. And also, I think, you know, I'd stored up in my head over the years, because I think if you're a fat person and you're walking down the street, people shout, particularly if you're a woman, they shout horrible stuff at you out of cars, you know. I've had stuff thrown at me, I've had people shout stuff, and on the very rare occasion I've been able to retaliate, I have done. But that's very rare because cars move and I can't run as fast as well.
So what's been sort of one of your worst moments up on stage? When's it gone wrong for you? Or has it ever gone wrong?
Well, I would say, like, I think this is kind of a really interesting scenario, this one. I'm going to use a very rude word now, and I apologise in advance. If you don't like very rude words, don't go like that. Well, go like that. I was comparing, hosting advertising awards, and one company kept winning all the prizes. So what I consider to be mildly taking the mickey out of them and going, oh God, not them again, you know. And then they won the overall prize for, you know, advertisers of the year or whatever it was. And the managing director came up to get the prize and I handed him over this cup. And as he was shaking my hand, he leant over and he whispered in my ear, I always knew you weren't funny, but I never realised what a cunt you were. Oh. And I just think that is totally unacceptable. So it was the end of the evening, so I said to the audience, thanks very much for coming, you've all been lovely, apart from whatever his name was, and this is what he's just said to me. And I told them. And it was really interesting, the reaction, you know. The reaction was really interesting because they all kind of went, oh, like that, you know. And then all his staff, not all of them, but some of them came up afterwards and said, he's such a horrible person, and, you know, and people won't stand up to him. And I think it is really hard for women because when you kind of get, you know, sort of sexist abuse, a lot of men are kind of quite clever about it, and they sort of isolate you and they make you feel ashamed that it's maybe your fault. And so if you try and speak up against it, you're humourless, you know, or don't you like being told you've got nice tits? It's all that kind of crap. And so I just kind of feel I've got nothing to lose, you know. People say to me, oh, you're fat and ugly, and I kind of go, really? How disappointing. Me, you know, that's not kind of, I don't care. I couldn't care less what some Neanderthal from Essex thinks about me. I really, oh, Essex, sorry. Yes. Yeah. No, no, actually, having said that, I've always had a great time in Essex, but do you know what I mean? I don't really care what some horrible guy like that thinks about me, so I don't care about doing it, but I think we're in, an interesting transitional period in terms of communication, because you've got a lot of, for example, Labour MPs, women, let's talk about them on Twitter, who get the most incredible abuse. And I think it's totally unfair that that abuse is anonymous. I don't think you should be allowed on Twitter unless you're prepared to identify yourself, and then people would start treating you the way that they would treat you if they were standing in front of you. And I think that that's only fair, really.
Would you be happy to be seen as a strong role model for women?
No. I'd rather be a model. I don't know. I think the thing is, you can get, you know, it's difficult territory. I'd rather just be a funny comedian, you know, and have people laugh at my jokes, really.
What do you remember the first gig that you ever did as a stand-up comedian?
Extremely well.
Okay, can you share that with us?
Well, I'd done 7 pints of lager. That's what I'd done. I was really, really nervous, and I got there at 7, and I had to wait till 12 to go on, and I was so drunk by the time I went on with my sad 5 minutes of material about Freud. And as soon as I started talking, these two guys at the back took against me and just started chanting, fuck off, you fat cow, until I did, in fact, fuck off after about 3 minutes. So, yeah, that was it.
And what gave you the courage to sort of come back again after that?
That I'd been so drunk and I couldn't remember the worst bits. There was a gig in Edinburgh called Late and Live. Has anyone ever been to that? It's a show, basically, where Scots people can come and hate English people because all the comics are English and all the audience is Scots. And it starts at 1 o'clock in the morning, so it is really hideous if you're an English comic. But I found the answer to it is to get as drunk as the audience, and then you don't care, it's brilliant. And I would just stand up on the stage going, and it was really good fun.
So what are your sort of favourite audiences, do you think? What's the Birmingham audience like?
Well, I would say the Birmingham audience is very easygoing, very generous and very relaxed. And I think, you know, like the South of England audience is a bit uptight. They're a bit over-entertained because they're near London. So their attitude's a little bit entertain us. Whereas Birmingham is kind of like in the middle, and Birmingham's kind of, yay, it's lovely to see you. Whereas some places, the further up north you go, it's kind of a bit more, you know, soft southern bastard kind of attitude. So that can kind of be quite hard. I think the hardest gig I ever did was I did a working men's club type gig in Burnley, and they so hated me at the beginning, and it was kind of my ambition to get through the gig and kind of turn them round, and I did in the end actually manage to do that, and I got some really big laughs, and it was just felt like a really big achievement, you know.
So who is it that makes you laugh?
My dad. He says lots of brilliant things. When I started doing comedy, he said to me, what do you wear when you go on stage? And I went, what's to wear what I normally wear? And he went, don't you wear a hat? That's sweet, isn't it? And so, yeah, my brother's very funny as well, my big brother. A lot funnier than me, I would think, naturally. I'm very good at telling jokes. And I love Dawn French and Jennifer Saunders. I loved Victoria Wood, God bless her. I love Linda Smith. I don't know if you know who Linda Smith was. She was a stand-up who died about 7 or 8 years ago. She's kind of a political left-wing stand-up from East London. She was absolutely brilliant. And she was actually named the most witty person on Radio 4, beating Stephen Fry. So that was a real accolade, but it was true. She was really great. Who do you like?
Who do I like? Mm. Oh, on the spot now.
Is it Roy Chubby Brown?
Yeah, it's a favourite. Say Joe no. Brand.
Mum.
It's too no. obvious, Mum.
Yeah, don't, Mum.
Right, so moving on. Interviewer. So you spoke about sort of you wanted to come onto the comedy scene because there weren't a lot of female comics. You've worked on sort of Have I Got News For You, QI. There aren't many women that actually get to go onto those shows. What is it like to be a female comic? What's
well,
the challenge?
Well, I think on those shows, it's a mixture of a lot of women don't want to go on them because they don't feel that they're that sort of comic that can kind of, you know, joust with the other comedians on the panel. And I kind of understand that really because, I mean, everyone has good days and bad days. And some days I'm on panel shows and maybe I've had much sleep or I'm a bit grumpy or, you know, whatever. And you get like the five worst jousters and interrupters on the panel with you. And you kind of think, oh God, I just haven't got the energy for this. So those shows, I just tend to stare at the floor and look miserable. And when you're watching them, people do that. They go, that woman comic's not said anything for 10 minutes, so therefore she must not be very funny. But what that gap is actually about, it's about that everyone else seems really confident to you. And so the first thing you say is really important. It's kind of got to work and it's got to get a laugh. So you build it so to be so huge in your head that almost, even if you said the funniest thing in the world, it wouldn't be funny enough. And so it's inevitably kind of going to be a letdown. And I think that's what particularly women and also inexperienced, nice, genteel comics as well. Because, you know, I've worked on shows like Mock the Week with male comics that just don't suit it either, because they're no after you, after you. Do you know what I mean? They're not prepared to kind of elbow their way in and be pushy. So not necessarily just a female thing, but obviously it does affect females more, really.
Would you like to see a sort of panel show like that that is purely just all females, or...?
Well, it's been mooted for years, and it's never kind of quite happened. And I'm not sure it's such a good idea, because that looks kind of contrived then, doesn't it? Although it's as though it's been kind of structured deliberately to, you know, to give the ladies a chance. And if there's anything, there's nothing much worse than being patronised like that as a woman, you know. And if you go and see stand-up in the clubs, there's a lot of women on stage these days, and they hold their own. And believe you me, that's quite difficult sometimes to do that. And so, you know, women are kind of gaining in confidence, and there are a lot more women around. And I think it will just naturally change. But of course, the other thing as well is, you know, women kind of sort of fade off for a bit. Like when I had kids, I didn't particularly want to be out every night, you know, jousting with some pisshead in Hull. I wanted to be at home with the kids. So, you know, it's a much more, to some extent, until we are completely equal, and that's not happened yet, has it? You know, it's a much easier job in many ways for a man to do.
You mentioned about your children there. You've managed to keep quite a relatively, your private life is relatively private for you.
Yes.
Has that been an important thing for you to keep?
Yeah, very much so, very much so. I don't like the press, and I think they're pretty unscrupulous, most of them, and they certainly don't like me. So it's kind of a mutual affair, and I kind of feel quite sorry for the kids of celebrities that are paraded around at, you know, every kind of BAFTA awards ceremony and film premiere going, really. So, and I think it's difficult for them not to feel sort of weird about it themselves as well. So I kind of wanted my kids to have as normal an upbringing as I could given the circumstances, really.
And how involved are your family with your comedy? Do you test jokes out on them before you go
out? Well, obviously my husband is the butt of most of my jokes, so that's been very useful. I remember once being at a conference with 700 builders. Oh my God. And I was thinking, I've got to say something about building them. And my dad's a structural engineer, and my brother's a quantity surveyor. So I just said, you're looking at me thinking, what on earth can a sort of menopausal chubster like me possibly know about building? But anyway, my dad's a structural engineer, my brother's a quantity surveyor, my husband's a fucking plank. I had to go home and say, I've called you a fucking plank, dear, sorry. Is that all right? And he said, well, it's a bit late now, isn't it? But it just worked so well. I knew that I would be using it again many, many times. So, so I think, you know, they're very supportive. My daughters, they're very funny, you know. I tried to keep it from them for as long as possible, really, what I was up to. But on her first day at primary school, my oldest daughter came home and went, Mom, and I went, yeah, and she went, are you Joe Brown? I am, yes. But they're kind of, you know, they're very well-balanced, really nice kids, so hopefully it's worked.
And if they ever wanted to sort of follow in your footsteps, would you encourage that?
People always say no to that, don't they? And I would encourage them, yeah. Because I think actually, you know, if you want a career in entertainment or whatever you like to call it, actually being a comic opens doors to so many jobs. Because a lot of comics I know, Eddie Izzard, you know, people like that, wanted to be actors, you know. And it's acting is so competitive, you know, 90% of equity members are out of work at any one time. But if you can hold down a job as a stand-up, you naturally start getting offered acting jobs, you know. I mean, I remember Linda LaPlante wrote a series about comics years ago and based a character on me. And they asked me to come in and kind of read for the part. I said, shit, I didn't get it. So that was one of my first acting disappointments. But, yeah, so, but it is, it's a good way in. And if you're interested in politics, you can sort of swan around in the area of politics. You can really, so many things you can do if you're a good stand-up, really.
So is there an avenue that you would want to go down that you haven't explored already?
Not really. I mean, I kind of feel very lucky because I, you know, I was even asked if I wanted to write some books, you know, and I felt quite guilty about that because there's so many struggling authors who write, you know, when they're at home after work and all that sort of thing. And I thought, God, they're actually asking me, you know, if I'd like to suggest something and do it. And, I did, I think I kind of finally fulfilled an ambition that I've had for a long time, which is that I did write a film script based on one of my novels, and that finally got made November, just gone. So I think that was probably my major ambition.
Brilliant. And is there anything else that you've got left to do now that you'd want to tick off that list?
Well, Hoover the house, maybe. No, that all gets neglected, I'm afraid. I've got friends who I can't possibly believe they let their children out of a cupboard because I go to their houses and they are so clean, you know. I mean, that's making me sound like a slattern, isn't it? But I don't know how people... We've got cats and a dog, and I don't know how people keep their houses looking nice. Because, you know, the dog pisses everywhere. So does my husband occasionally. See, I can't help myself.
So being the host of the British Bake Off wouldn't tickle your fancy at all?
No, I don't think so. I like doing Extra Slice because it was a bit more meaty, you know, because there were actually some great bits in that that I enjoyed doing, like interviewing the panel. And I used to love all the pictures of disastrous cakes that people sent in. I just kind of, I thought they were great, and it was just a really, really nice atmosphere. Whereas I think Mel and Sue were kind of, their hands were tied a bit on that show because they only got to come on and go, ooh, like that, like every kind of 10 minutes, didn't they? And then go home. And I think they could have just done so much more in a way.
So are you disappointed that they're leaving now, and obviously Mary?
Well, I thought they were a great combination. You know, the interesting thing, though, is if you see an interview that Mary's done or you talk to Mel and Sue, they don't really know what's going on either. I mean, no one's asked Mary, do you want to go to Channel 4, you know, with Paul? No one even asked her. I don't know whether she was meant to go and say, could I go to Channel 4 with Paul? But luckily, she didn't want to go anyway, so that sorted that problem out, you know. The BBC and the production company just have played their cards so close to their chest that nobody really knows what's going on apart from Paul, by the looks of it. Weird.
Okay, well, I've done with all of my questions, so I think it's time to open it up to all of you now.
Can I just ask you one very quick question? You still haven't told me your favourite comedian.
My favourite comedian?
Huh?
My favourite comedian?
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
Jack Whitehall, let me throw a few at you. No, from over there.
No, I don't. No, Eddie Izzard.
Yeah,
I do like, and I have met him as well, and he was very funny.
And he's a cracking marathon runner as well, isn't he? Oh my God,
he is indeed.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. No, thank you. Right, so we have a microphone over here. So put your hands up if you would like to ask a question.
But don't feel you have to. Because, you know, like when you go for a job and they go, have you got any questions?
So, got the lady over there? Yeah.
Hiya.
It was very interesting hearing it. Oh, is it on?
I think it is.
Well, my question was, do you get nervous before you go on stage or before you do an interview? And if you do, how do you deal with those nerves and handle it?
I do get nervous, but I get kind of graded nerves depending on how scary the experience is. So, for example, if it was that room full of 700 builders, I would be kind of 7 out of 10 scared. Whereas if it's kind of a talk in a library, I would be like 2 out of 10 scared, you know. My mum is, she lives in Ludlow in Shropshire, she's always making me go and do charity things up around Ludlow. And I did actually do a fundraiser in her library, and the first question I got was, what's it like being hated? Okay, lovely Ludlow. So in the old days, when I used to get scared, I used to like have a bottle of pills. And I also noticed once that I had a really storming gig and I just had to have 9 pieces of green toilet paper in my pocket. So that then became a sort of talisman. So every gig I did after that, I had to have 9 pieces of green toilet paper. And then, of course, it got to that. I said, you don't see green toilet paper anymore, do you? Well, it started disappearing from the shops and I started to panic, thinking my career was over. But thankfully, it lasted long enough to, you know. And these days, I just sit there and shake a bit, really.
Can you hear? Hi, Joe.
Hiya.
Fiona here, from just outside Ludlow. Oh. Travelled in.
Whereabouts outside Ludlow?
Well, I live near Prestine,
okay.
Between Leamington and Ludlow. It's lovely out there. And travelling here to work. It's so special. a couple of things, actually. Did you enjoy your big walk? And were you glad to when you got to the end?
I did enjoy it, really, from 7 in the morning till 4 in the afternoon every day. Then after 4, it was hideous, because it was getting dark. I'd already been walking for, about 10 hours. Most people would gather at the end and say things like, come on, Joe, you're nearly there, at which point I wanted to do that to them. I was just so tired and grumpy, and I kind of knew what was coming. And when I got to the end, which would be 9 o'clock each evening, pretty much, having started at 7 in the morning and had 2 20-minute breaks, and that was it. And then I'd have to have a cold bath for 10 minutes, and it was so grim. And then I would be pummeled, well, hit, really, by an ex-SAS physiotherapist. And then, rather hilariously, allowed to have a hot bath, but because he'd used lots of massage oils, couldn't bloody get out. I was like a kind of trapped whale. And I was, for the first night, I was trapped for half an hour before I worked out a solution on how to clamber out. Yeah, so yes and no, probably, the answer. Oh, yeah.
I probably shout loud enough. Hello, my name's Tony Taylor. I'm a Brummie. I'm interested, how do you go about actually writing a joke? Or how do you go about writing a whole evening? Because I've always assumed that if you're on the telly, you've got one chance. The joke's on the telly, you can't use it again, really. But if you're going around the club scene or now the bigger venues and whatever, presumably you write your own material and you've then got something for every show, or do you have to change it every day?
Oh, God, if only. No, I mean, it's interesting the way that it works. I mean, if you take, for example, a very famous stand-up like Tony Hancock, he did exactly the same hour for 16 years, right? And I'm so jealous of him, because it is really, really hard to write a storming joke. You know, I'd imagine the ratio is 20 failures to every one really brilliant joke. So basically, they say, you know, do your very best joke first, your second best joke last, and then put all the crap in the middle. You can a good bit. Lee Evans, for example, people do it very differently. Lee Evans, he writes with other people, a whole hour and a half new show, right? And then he starts in January at tiny little venues, 50-seaters, in pubs around London. And throughout the year, he builds the size of the venue up and up and up as the material starts to sort of settle in. And then by kind of August, September, he's in arenas, you know, and then he'll go on until Christmas. So he'll do a whole year of it. Well, basically, I mean, I would never fill an arena anyway, but I get, I don't feel that I want to do it that way. So what I tend to do is I get rid of a bit of old stuff and put maybe a quarter of new stuff in and just live in fear of people in the audience going, heard it. The worst heckle a comic can get, I think. And I think what you do when you're a comic that's been around for a long time, because you get so desperate to, you know, to have new jokes that are as good as the jokes you've done before, which is actually almost impossible, I think, is you become like a magpie and you just try and get jokes wherever you can. Now, I listen to conversations, I write things down, I think, oh yes, my mate Betty's had a hysterectomy, yeah, oh yeah, the doctor said that, yeah. Do you know what I mean? And so you pepper your set with kind of stories about your friends, stuff you've read in the paper. You do occasionally write jokes which are kind of, you know, structured, so in a proper joke structure, so you've got like a reveal at the end of them, you know, because I think there's 10 basic structures or something. But to me, it's a really chaotic mishmash, and I do actually have someone else that I write with. Sorry, everyone, he's a bloke. And, yeah, exactly. And he's a really brilliant writer, and what he tends to help me with, if you get asked to go on telly and talk about a specific subject, you know, and you've got a day's notice, I wouldn't have the time to write 3 or 4 minutes. So he kind of helps me with that sort of thing as well. But it's really, really difficult. It's really hard.
Thank you.
Okay, guy in the check shirt at the top there.
I love it when, you know, when David Dimble gives up questions, and he goes, the woman at the back with the yellow jacket, oh, sorry, sir.
No, definitely a man up here, so that's okay. Joe, thanks very much. That was a really fascinating talk. You were actually the inspiration for me doing a piece of linguistics research on Mock the Week, particularly round about language and gender, some of the issues that you were talking about earlier on. And I'd love to send you a copy of that if you would be interested in reading it. Excellent. That's good to know. Excellent. Good. That's what I like to hear. Just on that point, I was wondering if you could maybe talk a little bit about how you think the representation, the role of women in comedy could be improved. So the BBC a couple of years ago made the decision to have at least one female panellist, for example, on panel shows like Mock the Week. What we found is that doesn't necessarily improve kind of gender equality in these kinds of shows. Is this something that is down to the responsibility of production companies, script writers, editors even, or is it something more systemic than that needs to be addressed within the industry as a whole? I was just wondering if you might be able to share your thoughts on that.
Well, I think it's kind of a mixture of all of the above, if you know what I mean. I mean, for example, the sitcom Damned, which I do on Channel 4, which I wrote with a comedian called Morwenna Banks, she's also an actor as well. We originally did that for a one-off show for Sky, and they commissioned eight half-hour shows. And Morwenna and I were the only women writers that were commissioned for that show. So there were seven guys and us. And I mean, we were very lucky because they then wanted to commission a series from that. But so I think it's balance. I think, you know, that TV is a bit of a literally old boy network. You know, there are more women coming into it. But I do kind of feel that, you know, that there are quite a lot of women working in senior positions in telly who are very mindful of their own position, and they don't want to look too much like feminists in case, you know, the blokes start sneering at them and telling them to wear dungarees or whatever it is. And so I really think it's kind of difficult to get the balance right. And I think the other thing is to introduce different types of comedy. I mean, did you watch Fleabag?
Yeah.
Did people like that?
Yeah.
You see, I thought that was kind of really different because it was a theatre show. And it was and a lot of people said to me, oh, you know, I didn't like it because it was too cruel. How could a woman be so cruel like that? And that's one of the issues. People's expectations of women are still, they're a bit fluffy, the pretty ones. And they're not pretty kind of big ones. They're kind of just something we have to tolerate them because of equality. So I think it's many pronged really. And I'd like to sit at the table, but I don't think I'll ever get the opportunity. I once did the BBC used to do the, I think they still do them, these awful things called talent dinners, where you go to a very posh restaurant with a lot of other people off the telly, and there's controllers, because they're actually called controllers in the BBC. It's hilarious, like Stalinist Russia, isn't it? And then they ask you your advice about what would improve TV. Well, I was sitting right opposite Jeremy Clarkson, and I just couldn't help it. What about taking him off the telly? Of course, he just kind of went, all you ever talk about is periods, you know. I thought, do I though, do I? And I totted up my last kind of 7 stand-up shows, and I had 2 jokes about periods out of 7 hours of jokes, so I was relieved to find I didn't just talk about periods, and I thought I might have done.
No, that was absolutely brilliant. If you could tell your publicist to look out for an email from Robert Lawson and one of the tweeters behind you just now, I'll try and get that paper sent to you. Thanks very much for your answer.
All right, nice to talk to you.
Ben at the front down here.
Oh, hang on.
It's fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can shout.
What future comedians do you recommend that will come on the scene and make a success? What about Abdul Ray?
Abdul Ray?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you like him?
I think he's good.
Yeah, he does Citizen Cast, yeah. Doesn't he? Well, he's been around for a long time now, and he's a kind of consummate professional and a good comic, I would say. You see, the problem is, because my kids are a certain age, I don't actually really go and watch live comedy anymore. So I just tend to see stuff that I've watched on the telly. So what do I like on the telly? Well, I loved, I must think of something that's a bit more recent than Pulling, because that was years ago, wasn't it? What do you like, as well as Adil Ray? What else do you like? That's the main one you like.
Yeah.
See, the problem is I haven't got a memory either. But I'll come back to you when one pops into my head, because there are a lot of new, really brilliant comics around, I think. Phone Shop was a bit more recent. I liked that. I thought that was good. And I can't remember the name of anything. The one with the American guy and Sharon Horgan.
Catastrophe.
Yeah, that I like as well.
Can we get a mic down here at the front as well? Sorry.
Or do you want to shout?
Well, I just want to know more about Joe Brand the movie.
I wish it was Joe Brand the movie. It's Sheridan Smith the movie, actually. She starred in it. It's called The More You Ignore Me. It's set in the 1980s, and it's about 2 members of the same family that are obsessed with the Smiths. And one is a teenage daughter, and one is the mother who has schizophrenia. And I'm not going to say any more because I'll end up telling you the end. But it's got a fantastic cast. Sheila Hancock plays Grandma. I know, she was brilliant. And do you know who Mark Addy is?
Yes.
He was in The Full Monty.
Yeah.
Yeah, he plays the dad. He was amazing. So, you know. Hopefully September.
Okay.
That's unbelievable.
Hello.
Hiya.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Have you any thoughts about comedy and the subject of taboo? You know that tension between PC subjects and taboo, and do you have any boundaries? Or do you think, you know, just general?
I don't really have any boundaries. I think that's always been my problem. I don't actually think it's about which subjects are taboo. I think it's about how you approach those subjects. Because I think, in theory, you can talk about anything, disability, racism, anything, but it depends where you're coming from with it. So, you know, I wouldn't necessarily kind of rule out talking about race, but I would hopefully do it kind of very differently from the way, you know, someone like Bernard Manning might do it. You know, because I think it's important to talk about taboo subjects, because that's how change happens, isn't it, really? And I also think it's really important to have massive, great arguments with people. And I think it's I don't know if I'm throwing the cat among the pigeons here, but I do slightly have misgivings about this no platforming that goes on at universities. Because basically, why not give someone a platform and then argue with them and try and talk them round? And like someone like Jermaine Greer is a massive heroine of mine, and to see her get no platformed for an opinion that, you know, is worth discussing, I think is kind of sad and a bit wrong, really. So, yeah, you're all staring at me like, you are now officially no platform, and you're not coming back here again.
Oh, follow-up question?
Yeah, that's very difficult, isn't it? Yes, I think. I think everyone has to be aware in this day and age. I mean, I'm not in any way. I'm not in any way kind of supporting what he did or said. But David Davis made a really not particularly surprising sexist comment about Diane Abbott. But someone is somehow hacking into his text messages, his private text messages, to do that. You know, and everyone seems, oh God, he's so outraged because he made a joke about Diane Abbott not being very attractive. For fuck's sake, you know, 99% of women in this country know that goes on. And we're not exactly surprised that a stupid Etonian or whatever he is, like some idiot, like posh bloke from a private school, is making those sorts of jokes. But I'm not sure I necessarily agree that it is now open season on everyone who has a profile having their private messages being, you know, allowed to be displayed all over the media. I mean, I wouldn't particularly like my text messages to be read out. Even though I would like to, what was the awful, do you remember the Prince Charles Tampax thing? That was dreadful, wasn't it? That's when that all started. I kind of feel very ambivalent about the whole social media thing. And it kind of goes back in a way to why should some people be allowed to be anonymous on social media when others aren't?
We've got another question down here at the front.
It's actually a question from someone on Twitter who actually might be in here. It's a question from David Waters. David, are you here?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hi, David. Yeah.
Hi, David.
He says, as an experienced nurse, what advice would you have for our amazing VCU nursing students?
I think my kind of major advice to nurses would always be don't lose the kind of kind side of why you went into nursing, really. Because I think it's very easy to get caught up in the whole kind of professional side of things, you know. And when when I was a nurse, they brought in something called the nursing process to try and counteract the fact that particularly general nurses were going, oh, the liver in bed 17 and the brain tumour in bed 4, you know, because people were just reducing human beings to bits of them that weren't well. So I kind of feel like the best nurses I've ever worked with are nurses who do actually care about people and about doing the very best they can for those people. And I know in this day and age, nursing is a more and more difficult job, particularly in areas, public areas like A&E, you know, where you're dealing with people in very sort of high states of drunkenness, anxiety, whatever it may be. And I think you need to be a very special person to work in those sorts of places. But I suppose that would be my advice, really. And if you think you're being horrible, then do something else. Do get another job. Traffic warden, I don't know, whatever.
Okay, we've got time for a couple more questions. So this lady down here at the front.
Hi, my name is Diana. My question is, how do you see humour as a way of healing?
As a way of healing?
Yes.
Well, I think humour can be used as a means of healing because it's a great way to communicate with people and to relax them. I mean, first of all, we all know that laughing's really good for us. So from that point of view, it kind of releases, it has a physical biochemical effect on us. But I also think, a sense of humour that's shared kind of brings people together, really. And that places where there are no humour are kind of very dark, bare places. You know, I always used to, that was one of the big issues I had with Margaret Thatcher, actually. She didn't seem to have any sense of humour whatsoever, you know. And I remember particularly, there was one, I think she was on a visit to a factory and there were a load of young lads and one of them had some sort of thing he was using, a lathe or something, and she said, oh, that's the biggest tool I've ever seen. And they all pissed themselves laughing and she had absolutely no idea what they were talking about. And that was the problem with her, that you didn't really ever feel that she could communicate with normal people, because that is a big absence in someone's lexicon of social skills, I think, not having a sense of humour. So I would say from that point of view, it's very important. I mean, particularly, you know, a carer, service user relationship. I think if you establish a relationship which includes humour, it's kind of much warmer, really, much more relaxed.
Okay, one last question over here, man at the front.
Hi there, Joe. My name
Hello.
Is Mark Chan. I used to be a healthcare professional myself, and humour got me through the day. So was there ever a time when you were a nurse where you brought comedy into a situation or a moment?
Loads. I remember once someone put their roast dinner on my head when I was escorting someone to the canteen who, she was, bless her, she was lovely, she was slightly out of control, and I said, come on, we've got to go back now. She just went like that. And I said, all right, what's for pudding? And we had a laugh about it, you know. And there were just some really lovely situations which you couldn't do anything but laugh about. You know, we had a police cadet came on secondment for a few months, and he was like really, really keen. Bless him, he was very sweet. And so whenever there was an emergency, it would always be him like that, you know, running ahead of the pack to kind of sort the problem out. And we got a call to say there was a violent incident on the ward downstairs. So off he went, you know, miles ahead of anyone. And I got there and he had this woman on the floor and she was like screaming her head off and like really difficult to manage, mainly because she was Sister Mullet, the head of the ward. Because she was making such a fuss, he just picked the wrong one. And, you know, I think those are the sort of things that kind of keep you going, really. And You know, I think what people need to realise, because when I talk about my job, I would never kind of use humour to, you know, on stage where I'm taking the piss out of someone because of what their problem is. But I would much rather focus on kind of people's ignorance in a way around the whole idea of mental health, because people are so ignorant even in this day and age, and they're so unable to know how to deal with it, you know. And actually being friendly is a good start, I always think. Being relaxed, being friendly, having a chat with someone, you know. So I think humour really, really important.
Brilliant. We'll leave it there. Thank you so much.
Well,
for
it was
your
a pleasure.
Time,
thank you, Serena. Thank you.
No, follow that. As a northern man. I have to say, I really enjoyed it, Joe. And thank you, Serena, for asking the questions and drawing Joe out nicely. I think I have quite a formal rule here tonight, and that's to get us initially to say thank you to Serena. So could we thank Serena in the normal fashion? Particularly to thank Joe. I think I can't underscore the value of events like this. It's really good to hear your thoughts on much of what has formed you as an individual, and actually that you haven't forgotten your roots, you haven't forgotten your nurse training, and it's really interesting to hear you expound on that tonight. I think a special congratulations needs to go to you. So thank you very much.
Thanks.
Now, as you're aware, the City Talks are a series of events, and in what I can only consider to be a piece of irony, the next City Talk...
Roy on the Chubby Brown.
Just wait till you hear it. It will take place on the 22nd of March here in Parkside. An expert panel will consider what it means to be masculine in the 21st century.
I might come to that.
The reason I'm reading it is I don't want to get this wrong. How everything from gay pornography to Hollywood blockbusters and Tinder, the only way is Essex are fueling its diversity as well as its ambiguity. From bodybuilding to lad culture, and from metrosexual to the lumbersexual. And the masculinities of popular culture have never seemed so dynamic and generative. As a result, this City Talk will debate how men both negotiate and struggle with the identities of the modern world. It's an event hosted in partnership with the Shout Festival of Queer Arts and Culture. And you're all very welcome to come. Thank you once again. And thank you, special thank you for the audience coming in and making with the good questions. I think it's been a really well organised event, and once again, thank you, Joe.